and welcome back to Books with Burt. I'm Burt Folsom, and I wanted to continue our discussion of my book, The Myth of the Robber Barons, specifically continue our discussion of the Scranton Group. In our last podcast, we looked at the remarkable story of how the Scranton Group led the way for the American iron and steel industry to gain independence from Great Britain. Because of the surprise success of the courageous and bold Scranton Group, who mass-produced America's first rails in northeast Pennsylvania, the U.S. took a key step to becoming the world's greatest economic power by the year 1900. Because the Scrantons did what they did, thousands, perhaps even millions of Americans, had new opportunities in life. If they could just capture the Scrantons' vision, they had a chance to succeed. Let me give two illustrations about this point. One life that was made anew was that of Joseph Albright, the uncle of Selden Scranton. Albright was in business near Nazareth, Pennsylvania, and went bankrupt in 1850. He was nearly 40 years old. He had to sell all his furniture at a sheriff's sale and deal with creditors from two states. Albright wrote Selden, quote, "It is hard at my age to be thrown upon the world penniless," end quote. He even hoped that Selden's wife, quote, "wouldn't be ashamed of her poor friend," end quote. He even seems to have contemplated suicide and wrote that death would have been a relief to him. The Scranton Group came to Albright's rescue and offered him a job as a coal agent for their railroad, the Delaware, Lackawanna, and Western Railroad. Soon Albright caught the Scranton's vision. He was patient and invested wisely. He bought stock in the Scranton's Iron and Coal Company. He then joined them in building the city's gas and water system. On his own, he invested in a company to mill flour and in a firm to make locomotives. By 1872, he was worth $500,000, that's $10 million in today's currency, and he was elected president of the largest bank in the city. He had become a believer in the city of Scranton and wanted to help that city. He deeded, in fact, his home to the city and gave $125,000 to build a major public library to educate future generations in Scranton. Not everyone, however, joined the Scranton team. Albright did, but another relative, Philip Walter, also of Nazareth, resisted an elaborate courtship from the Scrantons in 1852. He told them he was reluctant, quote, "to pull up stakes and move from my long-cherished home because I might fail. I might fail." After a visit to Scranton, in which Mr. Walter sold hundreds of dollars worth of merchandise to an expanding population, he confessed, "I was quite enchanted with your place and the great though undeserved esteem in which I was held by many of the inhabitants." Mr. Walter also admitted, "I certainly could not find a place anywhere where I would rather go than to Scranton." He further said, "My sons would likely find openings for business in such a thriving place as Scranton appears to be and will yet become." Other men of means saw these advantages and settled in Scranton. But Mr. Walter avoided getting, quote, "carried away by the admiration of your thriving place." He was reluctant to uproot, and he had the haunting fear, "Still, I might fail." Winnowing out the cautious and the weak at heart, the city of Scranton seems to have attracted a select set of venturesome leaders to guide its industrial growth. In building their city, the Scrantons consciously promoted entrepreneurship. The securing of wide city limits was just part of this effort. They believed that their city would grow, and they diligently planned its expansion. Along these lines, the Scrantons and their allies established a Board of Trade in 1867 to promote the industrial development of their city. They installed an innovative Welsh immigrant as the board's first president. The Board of Trade actively recruited industry and even secured a law granting all new corporations tax-free status for the first 10 years they were in Scranton. In this open environment, Scranton grew as a manufacturing center and attracted many capitalists who were willing to take different types of risks. This made for a combination of inventiveness and creative entrepreneurship. For example, Henry Boies came to Scranton from New York in 1865 and founded the successful Moosic Powder Company. And then he perfected a gunpowder cartridge that reduced the death and injury resulting from carelessness in mining explosions. Boies seemed to court risky ventures and had failed twice before coming to Scranton. Once he had made his fortune in gunpowder, however, the credit lines were open, and he went to work inventing a flexible steel wheel for locomotives. He started his Boies Steel Wheel Company in 1888 to manufacture his patented invention. Another innovation that succeeded in Scranton was Charles S. Woolworth's 5- and 10-cent stores. Born in upstate New York, Woolworth, his brother Frank, and his partner Fred M. Kirby experimented in the late 1870s with opening of specialty stores featuring largely 5- and 10-cent merchandise. Shoppers were often skeptical of their first stores, and they did not do well, but then they came to Scranton. In 1880, Charles Woolworth set up a 5- and 10-cent store in Scranton, and the idea caught on. Today, this would be like merchandise of, say, $2 or $3 each. The sales in Scranton were a modest $9,000 the first year. But the Woolworths and Kirby had laid the foundation for an empire, and Charles had found himself a new home in Scranton. A decade of brisk sales in Scranton encouraged Woolworth to start branch stores in New York and in Maine as well in the 1890s. Soon, Woolworth's was selling nationally and became a major American corporation. Woolworth's, back in the 1800s, is somewhat like Walmart today, very dominant. In Scranton, Charles Woolworth joined with other local entrepreneurs in founding the International Textbook Company, which employed thousands of people to sell textbooks throughout the nation. The introduction of electricity in the 1880s brought out the best in Scranton's entrepreneurs. They didn't produce Thomas Edison, but they did have Merle Whiteman, who designed and built one of the first motors to run trolley cars by electricity. Scranton also became one of the first cities in the nation to have an electric trolley system. Sensing opportunity, Whiteman started his own company in Scranton to manufacture trolley engines on a large scale. Other Scrantonians tried to adapt electricity to coal mining. In 1894, they founded the Scranton Electric Construction Company, which perfected and manufactured electrical apparatus, that is, mechanical drills, locomotive hoists, and mining pumps, for use throughout the anthracite coal fields. Now, Scranton did not emerge inevitably as a center for manufacturing trolley motors, locomotive wheels, or textbooks. Nor was there any reason why the Scrantons should have their city become a major headquarters for a chain of 5- and 10-cent stores. Other cities throughout America had a good enough location and transportation to have been sites for these industries. Even the making and distributing of electrical mining equipment could have been done in Wilkes-Barre or in anthracite towns other than Scranton. A key to the Scranton success seems to have been the presence of aggressive entrepreneurs who had a philosophy of openness and a commitment to growth. As the spiral of growth in industries, services, and population persisted, the city of Scranton, which was founded on a hunch, officially became one of the 40 largest cities in the United States in 1900. A lot can be learned from the story of the Scrantons. The first lesson is that entrepreneurs are needed to create wealth. When they succeed, others then have the chance to build on what they started. If we look at the later history of Scranton, we can learn a second lesson, that it is hard for those on top to stay there in the generations that follow. An inheritance can be transferred, but entrepreneurship, talent, and vision cannot be. The industrial city of Scranton saw lots of movement down the ladder of social mobility as well as up. This can be seen if we look at what happened to the Scranton economic elite of 1880. Those men who made up the first generation of the city's industrial leadership. I collected data on the 40 men in Scranton who, by 1880, held the largest number of corporate directorships and major partnerships. These 40 men dominated all of Scranton's major industries. Several were millionaires, some multimillionaires, and all had access to credit and contracts, which seemingly should have ensured the success of their children in Scranton, which spiraled in population from 45,000 people in 1880 to 137,000 in 1920. As founders and developers of the Scranton vision, those 40 entrepreneurs had much to give their children. Blessed by the luck of the draw, these fortunate offspring could choose almost any career with the security that only wealth can bring. Raised in Victorian mansions, complete with servants, they often had doting parents to give them private school education, college if they wanted, or specialized training in engineering or industry. If these children did not prosper, they could fall back on hefty inheritances. Also, as they matured, they could take advantage of Scranton's thriving marketplace to make even more money. By 1920, the sons of Scranton's 1880 leaders had ample opportunity to succeed their fathers as the pace setters in Scranton's business world. Yet they did not. Few went hungry, but most could not come close to matching their father's achievements. Only 9 of the 40 economic leaders in 1880 had even one son, son-in-law, or grandson who 40 years later was an officer of even one corporation in Scranton. In short, the fathers and sons provide a stunning contrast. The fathers built the city of Scranton. Why did the sons do so poorly? Part of the reason for the startling breakdown lies in the general problem of family continuity. 6 of the families did not have any sons. 7 of the others had too many, which splintered family wealth into small pieces. In a very few cases, some sons left Scranton for business ventures elsewhere. Often the sons chose not to go into business, however. They led lives of brief and precarious leisure. The fragmentation of some of Scranton's larger family fortunes seems remarkable. For example, brothers Thomas and George Dixon became president of a national railroad, the largest manufacturing company in northeastern Pennsylvania, an iron company in New York, the vice president of the largest bank in Scranton, and directors on many other large companies. Just those two brothers. Yet only one of Thomas Dixon's 3 sons went into business. And under his leadership, the Dixon Manufacturing Company went out of business. George Dixon's only child, Walter Dixon, became a mere salesman and held no corporate influence. The 4 sons of multimillionaire James Blair were nonentities. Only one of James Blair's sons appears to have been gainfully employed, and his job was that of an assistant cashier in his father's bank. Even the Scrantons of Scranton were almost extinguished. George Selden and Joseph Scranton were the founding fathers of American rail making, yet only one of their sons showed any entrepreneurial skill. Selden was childless and went bankrupt in any case. George was worth $200,000 when he died, but his sons James and Arthur became men of leisure, not entrepreneurs. Joseph's son, William, gave business a try, but his story was often sad. Joseph was president of the Lackawanna Iron and Coal Company from 1858 until his death in 1872. But during these years, the New Yorkers bought up so much stock that William was not allowed to succeed his father as the company president. Young William Scranton was restless as a mere local manager, so he studied the new Bessemer process in Europe and returned to start the Scranton Steel Company in 1881. The city's low tax on new industries gave him an edge over the larger Lackawanna company. But the older company won the competition and absorbed his enterprise in 1891. William did prove to be a very capable builder and operator of the Scranton Gas and Water Company. He and his son Worthington ran this company profitably, and in 1928, Worthington Scranton sold it for $25 million. Some of the sons of Scranton's early industrialists literally squandered fortunes. Benjamin Troop, who was described earlier in the last podcast, became a millionaire in coal land and urban real estate. His surviving son had at best modest business skills. And when he and his wife died prematurely in 1894, the 83-year-old Troop undertook the task of rearing his only grandchild, 5-year-old Benjamin. The elder Troop died shortly thereafter, but young Benny inherited a $10 million fortune. Young Troop married into a prominent local family and, having no financial worries, began raising German Shepherd dogs. He served in World War I, but by that time his wife had divorced him, and he seems to have lost any interest that he might have had in gainful employment or in the city of Scranton. During the 1920s, like a character from an F. Scott Fitzgerald novel, he spent most of his time in Paris, indulging champagne tastes in cars and women. He married a French movie star and traveled widely during their marriage. Troop died in 1935 in his mid-40s, apparently dissipating his grandfather's entire fortune. Troop was a rare but not unique example of disillusion. Given the tradition of inheritances, many of the sons of economic leaders knew they would never have to work, so they became men of leisure with no business interests. For example, James Blair's son, Austin, was, quote, a gentleman of leisure with nothing to do except fish and hunt. According to a credit agent, quote, his father, James Blair, is a millionaire and supports him and lets him have a fine residence rent-free and supplies him with funds whenever required, end quote. Without strong parental guidance, a slothful life was understandably attractive to these sons of the wealthy Scranton first generation. Owing to the genetic improbability that Scranton's 1880 elite would produce only children like themselves with a knack for business, the fragmenting of economic leadership should not surprise us. John German had a son, Edward, but Edward became a horse racing fanatic at Honesdale or Goshen, New York. The son grew up under different conditions with different options in life that were available to his rags-to-riches father. The Troop and Blair families may provide clues to one possible relationship between parental guidance and entrepreneurship. On one hand, all of Benny Troop's parents and grandparents died before he was 8 years old, so he had no family pressure to become a businessman and pass along the family fortune. The four sons of James Blair, on the other hand, had a long-lived father who personally directed many of his own enterprises until his death at age 90. The elder Blair outlived two of his sons, and the other two had passed middle age by the time they were independent of paternal control. By living so long and holding on so tightly to his investments, Blair may have quenched the spirit of entrepreneurship in his sons. The role of parents, the lack of business talent, the quest for leisure, and the problems of family continuity in general all seem to have combined to fragment the Scranton economic elite of 1880. Of course, not all of Scranton's early industrialists had downwardly mobile sons. 9 of the top 40 capitalists in Scranton in 1880 passed the torch of leadership from father to son by 1920. In any randomly selected group of 40 families, of course, some would produce sons or have sons-in-law with a flair for business. This merely shows that the industrial leaders are much more likely than other groups in the population to father corporate officers. It does not show very much continuity of economic leadership because more than 3/4 of the industrial families to Scranton had failed to continue their line of corporate succession in the following generation. While most of the sons of Scranton's entrepreneurs stumbled, a variety of new immigrants to Scranton saw their opportunities and took them. By 1920, for example, Andrew Casey, an Irish liquor dealer, had become a bank president and a hotel owner. Michael Bosak, a Slovak immigrant who started life as a breaker boy in the coal fields in the 1880s, owned banks, a manufacturing company, and a real estate firm in Scranton in 1920. Few had the talent and vision to build such empires, but those who did picked up where the city's founders had left off. Scranton was, in a sense, America's first manufacturing city. It marked the spot where America began its independence from British iron. During the next generation, Scranton became a showcase of remarkable entrepreneurship and industrial growth. In this relatively open environment, Scranton's economic order was fluid. Upward mobility for the poor existed side by side with downward mobility for the rich. Entrepreneurs were prized possessions for cities and for the nation. Their vision, their talent, and their drive were hard to transfer, however, from one generation to another. Most of the families of Scranton's early industrialists died out as entrepreneurs. They didn't inherit their father's vision, and they turned over the city's economic leadership to newcomers. And so the cycle goes, which means that if Scranton is typical, two seemingly contradictory generalizations about the rise of big business in America are true. First, a small, constantly changing group of entrepreneurs consistently held a large share of the nation's wealth. Second, the poor didn't get richer, and the rich didn't get richer either. Here is one final point. We can see why so few of the sons and daughters of highly successful entrepreneurs follow in their father's footsteps. It's much easier and more fun to spend money than to earn it. Here is a list of the richest and most successful entrepreneurs of several generations ago. John D. Rockefeller, Andrew Carnegie, Henry Ford, Howard Hughes, and John Paul Getty. Yet none of these men had a son or a son-in-law or a daughter who had much economic success. Instead, their sons and daughters gladly spent the money their fathers earned. Do not take seriously the socialists who bemoan the fact that some 10% of Americans own about half the wealth of the nation. In so many cases, this 10% created the products and the wealth that the rest of us enjoy. Without these entrepreneurs, we would all struggle for our living. Also, please understand that the spectacular success of America's richest people is often fleeting. The Rockefellers, Fords, and Gettys may still have nice living standards, but they were replaced at the top of America's wealthiest Americans by Sam Walton, Bill Gates, and Warren Buffett. And these men, in turn, will probably be replaced in the next generation. The Scranton story is featured in my book, The Myth of the Robber Barons. I also would like to recommend the book by Stephen Moore entitled Who's the Fairest of Them All? Moore describes the impact of wealth and distribution of wealth in this book. And that concludes today's episode of Books with Burt. Thank you all for listening. Be sure to subscribe and rate my podcast on Spotify, iTunes, or any other place where you get podcasts so that you don't miss future episodes. And if you like today's episode and you want to find more content to fill your heart with love for America and conservative ideas, be sure to check out YAF.org. The conservative movement starts here. Until next time, keep reading.